Yeah, so good afternoon, everyone. And first of all, thanks to the organizers to have the opportunity to present a talk at this nice conference, which I really enjoy. And so during the day, we already had several talks about one of the main problems of the standard model Higgs sector, so the triviality problem, for instance, by Holger or by Francesco. So let's close today by talking about another big issue of the standard model Higgs sector, the electroweak vacuum stability problem. And parts of this work was done with several collaborations, and I think at least four of them attending also this conference. So probably you already heard it. The LHC works remarkably well in 2016. So at the end of August, they already reached an integrated luminosity of 25 inverse femtobon, which was basically the target for the whole year 2016. And of course, what you can do if you have such an amount of data, you can make a direct search for new physics beyond the standard model. And probably you also heard about this 750 GeV excess, where our friends from phenomenology and model building were quite excited about it. Unfortunately, it seems that this excess was just in statistical fluctuations and is completely dead by now. Well, but what you can, of course, also do is indirect search for new physics. Yeah, so for instance, in the standard model itself, you can check whether the predictions of the standard model fit to the experimental data or not. Now, for instance, you can check the various couplings of the Higgs to the other particles. And indeed, so the mass of the Higgs is in fact such a parameter which may point towards a scale of new physics. So in principle, in the classical theory, the Higgs mass is a free parameter of the theory. However, in a quantum theory, you can derive bounds on this parameter by our G arguments, as you can see in this plot. So what is depicted here is basically the Higgs mass given over the ultraviolet cutoff scale, which is basically the scale until the standard model is valid. So we view the standard model just as an effective theory. And beyond that scale, new physics should enter the game. And basically in perturbation theory, so these mass bounds were first computed, of course, in perturbation theory. The lower bound is given by the vacuum stability problem, while the upper bound is given by the Landau pole, or to be more precisely, by the triviality problem. However, the really important lesson from this picture is that for any given finite cutoff value, you only get a finite infrared window of allowed Higgs masses. Yeah, so if your Higgs is too heavy, you basically run into the Landau pole. If the Higgs is too light, the vacuum might be not stable due to top fluctuations. And you already can see, so if the the standard model Higgs mass of 125 GeV causes some tension with this lower bound. And if you basically investigate the perturbative effect of potential, get with the measured values of a Higgs mass of 125 GeV and a top mass of 173 GeV, an effective potential with this shape. So you have here our standard electroweak minimum of 246 GeV, but it seems also that top fluctuations can generate a second minimum at very high energy scales. And in the worst case, universe basically just can tunnel from this false vacuum state into the true one with rather traumatic consequences for your personal lives. However, there's an ongoing debate in the literature about this instability picture. So for instance, the second minimum occurs at some Transplanckian scale, and I personally would no longer trust a calculation which is done purely in the standard model with a second minimum at, I think, 10 to the 26 GeV or so. And of course, in toy models, there are also discrepancies to lattice studies which don't see such a behavior. And you can also show in toy models that you only can get emitter stability or instability in effective potential, basically if you choose implicit room normalization conditions which are in conflict with a well-defined partition function. So, because the standard model is a rather complicated theory, for a moment, let us restrict ourselves also to a simple toy model, because you can already read off most of the fluctuation-induced properties of this lower mass bound in such a simple U-cover toy model, where you have a real scalar field which represents the Higgs, and also a Dirac fermion which stands for the top quark. You couple both as in the standard model via U-cover interaction term, and we impose here a discrete Z2 symmetry on the potential in order to mimic the electroweak symmetry group, and we also impose a discrete chiral symmetry in order to protect the fermions against the cryo-Langer mass term. And then, of course, it's a quite easy task for you to calculate the one-loop beta function, for instance, for the running quartic coupling. And then, clearly, the term arising from the pure top quark loop comes with a negative sign. And this basically just means that the integrated quartic coupling decreases in an infrared to UV perspective, which is also fine so far. So, but now if you construct the effective one-loop potential in perturbation theory, you make certain assumptions. For instance, you assume that the potential has basically a phi-4 type. Then you impose certain renormalization conditions on the mass term in order to get an electroweak minimum at 246 GeV. And you take here as a quartic coupling, basically the integrated quartic coupling from this beta function, but you identify the running RG scale with the field amplitude. And then clearly, if the quartic coupling drops here below zero, then you get, so in this particular toy model, you would get a complete instability. That is basically the perturbative picture. However, in the simple toy model, the fermions only appear as bilinears. So you basically can integrate them out, and you can investigate basically the fermion determinant. And what you obtain is that the interaction part of this fermion determinant is basically a strictly monotonic increasing positive function for every field value in this effective field theory framework. So in principle, it should not be possible that fermion fluctuations can induce here such an instability. And let me also emphasize, in principle, the evolution of the scalar potential is a multiscale problem. So the full effective potential in field theory would provide separate information for all scales involved, while in this case you mix up momentum scale information with the field amplitude. But however, all of us know a quite good method to investigate such a multiscale problem on a perturbative as well as on a non-perturbative level by the Wetterich equation. So for the Wetterich equation, you just make a simple derivative ansatz for the effective average action. From that, you obtain the flow equation for the scalar potential, depending on both, of course, the field amplitude as well as the RG scale. And you can also derive the flow equations for all other couplings involved in the system as well as the anomalous dimensions and so on and so forth. This is now a complicated partial differential equation system which you have to solve. And in order to solve, you really need a good PDE solver, because you really have to track the potential over a huge range of field amplitudes, and you also run over many scales, so basically in the ideal case from the Planck scale down to the electroweak scale. And we use here PDA solver based on pseudospectral methods. Well, unfortunately, my numerical abilities are very limited, but fortunately we have two clever PhD students in our group, so Julia Borchardt as well as Benjamin Knorr. Both of them have also a poster, and they applied their pseudospectral methods to several problems. And yeah, if you have time, maybe in 10 or 15 minutes during the poster session, I strongly recommend approach these guys if you have a hard numerical problem. Okay, now we have our flow equations. We have a quite good solver. What we of course also need are some initial conditions on the UV cutoff scale. And just as a first test, let's just restrict the bare potential to the perturbatively renormalizable operators, which basically means up to phi 4 coupling. And just, of course, this is still a toy model, but just in order to come in contact with the standard model, we fine tune the bare mass term or the bare vacuum expectation value, depending if we start in the symmetric or the symmetry broken regime, in order to get an electroweak scale of 236 GeV, and then we also tune the bare Yukawa coupling in order to get a top mass of 173 GeV. And this is now an example flow for a potential with a cutoff starting at a cutoff scale of 10 to the 9 GeV. And on top of the log-log So in the coffee break, it worked. So basically what you will see here the RG slicing scale running down towards the infrared, and then you will basically see how the effective potential is built up. I think the...
What if...
Yes, so sorry for the delay. Feel free to think about your numerical problem, which you will bring to Julia and Benjamin. Also put. Then I will tell you what should happen in principle. Okay. So what you basically will see is just that the effective potential will build up by integrating out the quantum fluctuations, and you will basically see at the end of the flow that we just get a single minimum here at 246 GeV as it is constructed, but we don't observe any instability at all at large scales. And this small plot here is just because some of my collaborators don't like this log-log type plot, how the electric minimum looks in this log-log type form, and this is basically just a zoomed in version where you can see then at the end the usual double well form. Okay. After we have computed the effective potential, or not, of course we can extract from the effective potential the Higgs mass, the infrared Higgs mass. And this is done here, for instance, for various values of the cutoff for vanishing bare quartic coupling. Okay, if you now crank up the coupling, These are the results for 0.1, 1, 10, 100. And what you basically found is that the Higgs mass is a monotonically increasing function of the Baire-Quartic coupling, as you would expect. And therefore, you get from this RG perspective, running down from the UV to the infrared in an effective field theory approach, that a natural lower bound emerges just from the fact that the value for the Baire-Quartic coupling is bounded from below in order to start with a well-defined Baire potential in the UV, such that you have a well-defined partition function. And this is, by the way, in great agreement with non-perturbative lattice simulations. This would basically just mean that a Higgs mass outside this mass bounds cannot be connected to any conceivable sets of Baire parameters. And therefore, you get a clear answer. For instance, the Higgs mass is, of course, this is now just a toy model, but if the Higgs mass would be 200 GeV, then there would be a scale where new physics should set in at roughly 10 to the 9 GeV or so. OK. If we are already in the framework of effective field theories, of course, it's rather expected that there will be also other higher order operators at the standard model cutoff scale just generated by the underlying theory of the standard model. Yeah, and of course, clearly, you can choose a negative Baire-Quartic coupling in the UV if the potential is stabilized by higher order operators. Yeah, and for instance, these are example Higgs masses where we choose the Baire-Quartic coupling negative, but we're choosing a fixed Baire coupling for the phi to the sixth term. And you clearly see that the lower mass bound no longer holds if also higher order operators are permitted. And the reason for this from an RG perspective is quite simple. Yeah, so basically, of course, for the potential, this is not the full story. The complete non-perturbative structure will be generated during the RG flow. However, if you for a moment just consider the running of the Baire-Quartic coupling as well as the phi to the sixth coupling, you basically understand the main mechanisms why we can diminish this lower bound. And the reason is basically that you, in principle, can map a theory which starts at some UV cutoff scale with a vanishing Baire-Quartic coupling and vanishing phi to the sixth coupling, which would correspond to this black curve here, to a theory which has a positive phi to the sixth coupling in the UV, but a negative Baire-Quartic coupling. And so, roughly speaking, you can view this orange and this red curve here as a horizontal displacement of this black curve, roughly speaking. Of course, you can also ask yourself what happens if I don't restrict myself to the case of lambda 3 is equals to 3. Yeah, for instance, these are basically the curves for lambda 3 is equals to 1 and lambda 3 is equals to 10. And what you basically see is that you cannot push the lower the scale of new physics to arbitrarily large scales, basically because the running of this higher order operator is basically dominated by its power counting behavior. And that is also the reason why you cannot further stabilize the Baire potential by a phi to the 8 coupling or phi to the 10 coupling or any polynomial coupling. We also tested this by generalizing, for instance, the recover interaction to a phi to the 3 psi bar psi interaction term and so on. And the main message is you cannot beat power counting. Because what happens, so for instance, I could also choose here just blindly, I enforce lambda 3 is equals to 3, and then I would further decrease this Baire-Quartic coupling here. And what happens then is quite interesting. Because as I have told you before, in the case of phi to the 4 type potentials, you at the end, so the black curve here is the effective potential, you get always a stable effective potential at the end of the flow, However, if you further and further decrease the Bear-Quart decoupling for any given value of lambda 3, you already seed a meter stability in the Bear potential. So our results don't show that there is no meter stability at all in the effective potential, but if there is one, it has to be seeded already in the Bear potential and has to come from the underlying UV physics. And it's not necessarily related to top fluctuations. And basically, this red curve here shows you the border between you have a stable scalar potential during all the RG scales, and below this red curve, even in the class of higher order operators, you already seed a meter stability from the underlying theory. But this is somehow different as this meter stability occurs in the standard model. Of course, what you can also do in the simple model, you can do for the full standard model Higgs sector. And this is, of course, a little bit tedious to deriving all the flow equations, but more or less a straightforward task. And basically, also for the full standard model Higgs sector, the same mechanisms are at work. You get a lower bound and also an upper bound, naturally from the RG flow itself. You restrict yourself at the standard model cutoff scale to 5^4 Bear potentials. And of course, if you investigated extended Bear potentials on a polynomial type, you can diminish this lower bound, but not arbitrarily low. So the most important point for the phenomenology question is, what I really can, so basically what is the difference between this red mass bound within the 5^4 class and also the mass bound derived from higher order operators at the UV scale. And at the Planck scale, the difference between two bounds is roughly 1 GeV. So if the Higgs mass stays at 125 GeV and the lower bound, I think it's around 128 or 129 GeV, it strongly depends on the precise value of the top mass, so let's say the lower bound is 128 GeV, then you can diminish this lower bound by higher order operators by 1 GeV, so that would mean 127 GeV. So you see, there's still some tension, at least if you wish that the standard model is valid up until to the Planck scale. But as it was mentioned in the first talk of this parallel session, of course, you can also go at a standard model cutoff scale to some Bear actions or to a Bear potential which is beyond polynomial order. Yeah, so for instance, we tested so far several log-type Bear potentials or also some rational functions. So in principle, the dream would be you start with a stable Bear potential in the UV, you integrate down the flow towards the infrared, you get an electric minimum of 246 GeV, a Higgs mass of 125 GeV, and a complete stable potential all the way up. It turned out that isn't so easy. So far, I haven't tried periodic potentials in the UV, but I have learned that I should approach poster number, I think it was 14, right? Yeah. But, yeah, so that is really quite a hard task. So it's straightforward, really, to construct such Bear potentials on a mean field level, where you only include the fermion fluctuations, and you can handle the problem more or less analytically. That is really straightforward. But as soon as you include the bosonic fluctuations, they have such a huge impact because you have deformed the Bear potential in such a strong non-perturbative way that is quite hard to obtain the correct infrared physics. So you can really write down very fancy Bear potentials which result in more fancy effective actions. So for instance, you can construct a Bear potential where your effective potential has a minimum at 246 GeV, but the Higgs mass is as large as the Planck scale. Well, that is basically our current task to basically scan possible bare potentials in order to construct effective potentials more or less which have the properties we would like to have too. And in order that the chairman will not kill me, feel free to read the conclusions, and I am happy for questions.